Hello and Happy New Year's. Cort Lindahl here with you. Hope everyone had a good holiday and a Happy New Year. Just here to update you about some stuff. Still working on the White House Meridian video and another video about Castel del Monte. I'd forgotten I had already made one. Sometimes I've made so many videos I forget what I'm doing. But I'm also gonna just, you know, say here that I'm going to be backing off the Oak Island subject matter. I've kind of worn that one out. I basically think there is an explanation for all of that in recorded history, and there's a couple of different things that could be going on there. One, that there was Jacobite funds that were then turned towards the American Revolution. And other possibilities are people like Admiral Anson and elements of British royalty possibly had squirreled away some of the funds from Fortress Louisbourg there. And from either Louisbourg or the Jacobite gold, these things could have ended up being used to plan the early stages of the American Revolution. We do have Ben Franklin actually owning a chunk of Nova Scotia. He was awarded during the time he was basically an English intelligence asset. And that's one thing noteworthy about Benjamin Franklin, is during his time before the American Revolution, he was close friends with Sir Francis Dashwood, who was kind of one of the quote spy masters of that era, the mid 1700s era, and a little later. And he worked in cahoots with the Anson brothers in possibly targeting large amounts of French gold or Spanish gold that then they would get a portion of, or squirrel some of it away in a place like Oak Island for a while. And I also feel that there's proof that they may have invested some of this money in fine art, and that's one way they sort of laundered the money. So that's what's going to be going on with me with Oak Island. I've pretty much said everything I have to say about Oak Island. And I mean, if I find something more, a solution to the whole thing, I certainly will let you all know, but I'm going to be concentrating on other things in the near future, searching for other subject matter to write about. I've kind of worn out a lot of the things I talk about all the time, and I may actually go back to making a video or writing more about the strange street plan of Chico. I found out a lot more about that since I first discovered that. I was quite surprised to find that while I was studying the Axis Mundi and geographic concepts as related to occult or hidden beliefs, that Chico indeed had been built with a city plaza that represented an Axis Mundi, and the street in Chico called the Esplanade is even a Latin word that describes a flat open area adjacent to an Axis Mundi. So some of the accounts of John Bidwell, the founder of Chico, even have him plowing a circle in the city plaza in a ceremony that's kind of reminiscent of how Constantine the Great defined the boundaries of the royal district of Constantinople, today known as Istanbul. So Chico's an interesting place to look at the development of a small town that was built from scratch, out of nothing. So that's very interesting. And so the original 8x8 block design was just wrought of simplicity, but it does resemble a chessboard, and the city plaza is in the Queen's Square. And it's also interesting that the city plaza aligns with the home of John Bidwell. Bidwell Mansion, which is a fine, large Italian Renaissance structure that you can still visit today in Chico and take tours of Bidwell Mansion. But what's interesting about that whole legacy is that the story of Annie Bidwell, who was from Washington, D.C., and her full name was Annie Ellicott Bidwell, and she was related to Andrew Ellicott, who actually laid out the plan of Washington, D.C., and took over the job of designing the city after Pierre L'Enfant withdrew his services in that realm. So it's very interesting that there's even historical accounts or old newspaper articles of Annie Bidwell actually assisting John Bidwell in surveying and laying out the streets of the town, and her being from Washington, D.C. is interesting given the kind of all the symbolism and odd things about the streets of Washington, D.C. that many people point out, including myself, in the video that I'm working on about the White House Meridian. It's taking a long time because there's lots of stories and I have to kind of choose what parts of the stories to tell or not. And that's one of the reasons I haven't finished that yet. I'm still kind of continuing to supply you with these shorter videos just discussing things I'm doing. So that's an interesting connection between Chico and Washington, D.C. And Chico has all kinds of alignments associated with the City Plaza and Bidwell Mansion. So it's an interesting story. And also in the area here, in the Chico area, is the Monastery of New Clairvaux, which is interesting because they actually built a 12th century Cistercian chapter house here in Vina, California, about 18 miles north of Chico. And you can go there and see, even today, Mason's marks from the original stonemasons. And that's a really interesting story as well, because it came from the Monastery of Santa Maria de Ovila in Spain, which does have an association with other strange stories of the Holy Grail. All right, back with you. We were talking about the Monastery of New Clairvaux and how a chapter house was rebuilt there that was originally constructed in the 12th century at Santa Maria de Ovila in Spain, and it was a Cistercian chapter house. And we all know the associations between the Cistercian order and the famous Knights Templar. So what's interesting about Santa Maria de Ovila, where the building originally came from, is its association with an interesting Holy Grail story in Spain. And I'll be going into more detail about that. I did comment on that on the episode of William Shatner's Unexplained that I appeared in, season 3, episode 1. So check that out if you all get a chance. And I've got some more details coming about that. So it started to rain here. I'm sure you can hear that pounding on the roof. So some of the other things I'm going to be working on, or that we can discuss now, are my interest in Rennes le Chateau, I think, has really been connected to the stories of Oak Island and Shugborough Hall via probably, most likely, the Martinist Order. So see my videos about the Priory of Zion and the Martinist Order for all those connections to the story of the Cremona document and more. Now, I don't believe the Cremona document has anything to do with medieval times or the Knights Templar. I think it was all created by the Martinist Order in the late 19th century. And really, if you look in detail, even the legendary so-called Hooked X is valued by the Martinist Order, and that's the reason that symbol is on the maps, on Zena's map, and the other map that's part of the Cremona document that shows the location of Oak Island also having a longitude of 66 degrees and 6 minutes. So it's an interesting 666 connection that was intentional. But it is of interest in that the prime meridian that's associated with, or zero point on the globe, was a meridian created by the Cassini family, whose names continually pop up even in studies of Rennes le Chateau. Their influence was seen also in the famous book The Da Vinci Code that involves the Arago markers. And the other meridian, just a few hundred meters west of the Paris meridian at Saint-Sulpice. They have the shadow gnomon in there that also establishes a meridian and lets you measure time or different dates of the year. That was part of the plot of the movie as well. So there's some interesting connections to that. The Cassini family were involved in that. And Cassini I, or Dominique Cassini, actually created a meridian at the cathedral in Bologna, Italy, that I have video of on my video here on YouTube entitled Axis Mundi, The Masters of Time and Space. So look at that footage shot by my friend Simon Naylor that's included in that video that shows the gnomon and how it works, how an aperture in the side of the church actually can be used to measure time, which is important to the church as far as feast days and holidays and managing the calendar over the centuries. So it's interesting that another one, another gnomon, is located at Santa Maggiore in Rome that's very similar to the one in Bologna. And it's very interesting that the array of windrows, markers, and obelisk, and kind of the keyhole-shaped array of St. Peter's Square, actually points to Santa Maggiore. It's all involved in timekeeping and the tradition of the winds, or the cardinal directions with regard to true north or the pole star. And that's something that's central to an appreciation of the Arcadian theme as well. Another thing I've stressed in my work is the story of Arcas, the Greek mythological character, who, like one of the stories associated with Arcas, is him being cast into the sky as Ursa Minor, or the Little Bear, and his mother Callisto being cast into the sky as the Big Bear, or Ursa Major. So the tale of Ursa Minor, or Arcas, includes the pole star. And this is a very basic tenet of cartography, how to create a prime meridian by sighting the pole star, which is in line with, of course, the polar axis of the Earth. So that's one of the things, the secrets of Arcadia, that's being told. And I also feel that a lot of people misinterpret the symbol of the five-pointed star when it's kind of being used in an Arcadian, context. Because the star would mean the North Star and not anything to do with Venus. Not to say that there's not another occult or hidden value of Venus in that manner, that based on the orbit of Venus in relation to Earth, that it can make five regular points, but the fact that the pole star, it is more associated with the origins of the name Arcadia and its namesake Arcas, the Greek mythological character, who interestingly is also associated with the origins of what the werewolf is. Another story involving Arcas has King Lycaon, and that's even a word that is the root word for the Latin word for wolf, tried to trick Zeus into eating Arcas because he had placed him on the brazier and tried to serve him as food to Zeus. So Zeus, of course, being all-knowing, knew this and turned Lycaon into a creature that is very much like a werewolf, and this very well may be the origins of the whole mythology of the werewolf that's evolved today into what we know in the movies. So that's an interesting story as well. So in that way, Arcus is associated with geographic mysteries. These stories I keep telling you about what a prime meridian is, or a line of longitude that's central in the way that astronomers communicate with each other. Astronomers were among the first people that could plot their relationship to other points or other astronomers or places where other observatories were and compare their findings and even predict when celestial bodies would rise above the horizon where they were by knowing their track from another position. So this led to being cartography more accurate as well, that we see the Cassini family utilizing and in their famous map of France, and the prime meridian that served as the zero point for the map of Oak Island that's in the Cremona document. So I keep stressing these things over and over. Sometimes I can't believe, even though I had a relationship with the TV show and the producers of The Curse of Oak Island, that I've told them these stories and they don't seem to understand and or value them. And I feel it's central to really understanding what's going on. So that one of the drawbacks of TV, you can't go into detail. I can't say everything I want to say. And it's based on entertainment and not information, that like what I'm trying to give you here. So the Cassini family even had a huge influence on Thomas Jefferson, who is a person that was also intimately aware of the meaning of Arcadia and had an appreciation of Philip Sidney's book Arcadia. That, hello again, here's another story that, you know, how can one read the passage of Sidney's Arcadia that includes a money pit with a graven stone at the bottom that's described sort of like the 90-foot stone, complete with parchments, like pieces of parchment have been found in the money pit on Oak Island. How this story did influence the story of Oak Island and the way it was being told. And in my book, Timeless Arcadia, I lay out a whole string of ways that the Stuart family of English kings valued the concept of Arcadia. And this includes everything from Star Castle on the Isles of Scilly to the Newport Tower. It explains what these things mean. And descriptions of those are also present in Philip Sidney's book, Arcadia, in addition to a description of the money pit. So right there from one book, there's inferences that these ideas had already been explored by Philip Sidney, who was, of course, closely associated with people like Dr. John Dee, his father-in-law, Sir Francis Walsingham, who was like the chief intelligence gatherer of the Elizabethan age, along with his cohort, Thomas Randolph, who was a direct ancestor of Thomas Jefferson, and indeed is most likely who he was named for. So the closer you look at the real history and things you can actually prove, you know, in dispute maybe with what may be considered entertainment, is of more value in my opinion. So I would urge everyone out there to actually read my books, and don't stop there. Look for all the sources that prove all of this is true, that there was a value of the prime meridian. And that's why it's when you see a treasure story that might involve a map or geographic clues or references to a certain building and aspects of the stories like that, that you might be being told a story that's a legendary story meant to teach you something else. And so that's kind of what one learns when they look into the story of Rennes le Chateau, for example. You learn about late 19th century secret societies, people like Peladon, Papus and company, Auguste Labouisse Rochefort and his friend Pierre Hubert Anson, that he claimed was a member of the Anson family of Shugborough Hall. So these facts can only lead you to more speculation, but it's all based on real historical evidence. And it's especially hard to convince people that things in literature, you know, influenced stories like Oak Island and others, because it's obvious that it's true, including in an older piece. I told you how, watch my video about Castel del Monte, and I document in there how the medieval novel Amadis de Gala was written at Castel del Monte, that in turn influenced the famous book Don Quixote, which is a parody or makes fun of Amadis de Gala. But there's a passage in Amadis that also resembles the Oak Island story, with a treasury on what is known as the Firm Island that's surrounded by invisible forces that only let the knight that's worthy of obtaining the Holy Grail through the gauntlet. So it's interesting that the story originated at Castel del Monte, built by Frederick II, written by Enrique the Senator, and who was an ally of Frederick's family. So he was telling us real things about Frederick the Great and his values and his family's values in the pages of this fictional story. Now, given that, it's also terribly interesting that Frederick II, who built Castel del Monte, there's scant sources that say he searched for the temple treasure. Because the temple treasure, one of the most famous theories about the temple treasure is when it was sacked from Rome. We see originally Titus, under the auspices of Emperor Vespasian, brought the temple treasure to Rome in about 70 AD, where it was displayed at the Temple of Peace of Rome. And then we come to the early 5th century, when the Visigoths sack Rome and steal the temple treasure, including the golden menorah, the golden leavening table, and possibly sacred stones, known as the teraphim as well, that were things like the pillow stone of Jacob and other natural stones that were valued for spiritual reasons. So the most popular story is that Alaric, the Visigothic king who sacked Rome, brought the treasure to Cosenza, Italy, where he actually changed the course of a river and built a tomb in the river, and as a treasury and his tomb. And then when he died, he and the treasure were placed in this, and the course of the river was changed back to what it had been before. So that's interesting that later in history there's a story of Sir Francis Bacon's papers being hidden in a similar manner in the River Wye in England. But it's interesting that if we look at Castel del Monte as if it were marking a prime meridian valued by Frederick the Great, as in the tradition of many of these other octagonal structures that Castel del Monte is directly due north of Cosenza, and the prime meridian created by Castel del Monte passes just to the east of the town in the riverbed where the treasure is supposed to be hidden. So that's an interesting story. Now, a really kind of bizarre crossover to the story of the Priory of Zion also exists in Calabria, in the vicinity of Cosenza, where the original monks that comprised the actual Priory of Zion at Our Lady of Mount Zion Church in the Holy Land during the Crusades came from this very area where the temple treasure was said to have been hidden. So that's kind of a compelling thing, no matter where you come down on the story of the Priory of Zion. Were they a later creation of the Martinist order, as the story of Rennes le Chateau indicates, or were they really as described in the book Holy Blood, Holy Grail? And we don't know for sure, but we do know that there were two different orders of medieval monks referred to as the Priory of Our Lady of Mount Zion, one of them actually at Mount Zion, and the other one in Orleans, France. So it's an interesting concept that the temple treasure was there. The Priory of Zion claims to have the temple treasure today, and the original priory came from the area around Cosenza, Italy, where people have searched for the temple treasure, including the famous French author Alexandre Dumas, who wrote the famous book The Three Musketeers. And it's interesting, as part of this story of Dumas searching for the temple treasure, there is a letter he wrote to an Italian police official in which he claims that Edgar Allan Poe helped him on this story, and that Poe had actually visited him for a six-month period and lived with him in Paris. Though, of course, there's no real record of that. We do know Poe was kind of a spy in some regards, a very hyper-intelligent man who would have been a benefit to any treasure hunt of that nature. So it's interesting that this story, which that's all it may be, of Alexandre Dumas saying Poe was helping him to find the temple treasure, and indeed he was looking in the vicinity of Cosenza, Italy, just like there are legends of Frederick II, Holy Roman Emperor and King of Jerusalem, also searching in that area. Now, a lot of people would try to connect this story of Frederick and the temple treasure to the Knights Templar, but Frederick had an adversarial relationship with the Knights Templar, who did not like him. At one point he negotiated a peaceful deal with the Muslims that allowed pilgrims to go to the holy places in Jerusalem, but included the fact that the Muslims would retain control of the Temple Mount, where the Dome of the Rock is, and the former quarters of the Templars. So when Frederick did that, it enraged them even more. So he was known as a very intelligent man. He was known to be adept at astronomy, and he even had a so-called magi, a man named Michael Scott, who many literary scholars refer to as having inspired the image of Merlin in the Grail romance literature. So he learned astronomy from Michael Scott, and Frederick II was also one of the only European nobles of that era to write a book, and he wrote a book about falconry, which you can still read and see today. So Frederick II, the Hohenstaufen Holy Roman Emperor, is a really interesting man, and it's interesting that this piece of literature, Amadis de Gala, was written at Castel del Monte, which unfortunately most of the decorative elements of Castel del Monte were looted long ago and are said to be in local estates, but there is one interesting statue of Pan there, which was original to the construction of the building, and we all know Pan as a denizen of Arcadia, so I would not be surprised if someone like Frederick II was a fan of the poet Virgil and had been inspired by all of the Arcadian mythology, just like subsequent rulers, including the Medici family, who married into French nobility and brought this value with them. Charles I of England married Henrietta Marie, who was the daughter of the Queen of France, Marie de Medici. And this is how I believe that Philip Sidney's Arcadia came to be valued as the English version of the Arcadian mythology. And again, makes it interesting that there's a story in the book very similar to the story of Oak Island that you can read on my blog. There's a story about Philip Sidney and Oak Island that includes the passage of the book that tells about a money pit, golden acorns, parchments, and engraved stones at the bottom of the pit. So there you go. I hope you all enjoyed my ramblings this time. I know I fluttered around from subject to subject, but there's articles about all of what I've spoken about on my blog for free. Just word search Cort Lindahl blog, and a link will pop up, and there's an index at the top of the page with a variety of stories, including the story of Imadas de Gala and Don Quixote, the story of Philip Sidney and Arcadia, Thomas Jefferson, and much more. The story of the Cremona document maps and how the prime meridian matches a meridian created by the Cassini family. So also don't forget to possibly become a member of my YouTube channel. And I also have a Patreon account that you can donate if you feel like you want to. But there's 120 free videos on my YouTube channel, Cort Lindahl, and including this podcast, number 4. Thanks for joining me, and I hope you all had a great New Year.